Welcome to the Real Estate Espresso Podcast, your morning shot of what's new in the world of real estate investing. I'm your host, Victor Menashe. On the show, we have AMA episodes, that is, Ask Me Anything. If you have a question you think is going to be of broad interest, send it in. I'll answer it live on the air. Send your questions to Victor at victorjm.com. That's Victor at victorjm.com. On today's show, we're talking about what's up or what's down with interest rates. Interest rates are traditionally influenced by two main factors, inflation and risk. If inflation goes up, then naturally investors want their bonds to at least keep pace with inflation. If the investment is perceived as having higher risk, then investors want a premium to compensate them for the higher risk. These are the two principles at work in pricing interest rates. But of course, there isn't a single interest rate. There are short-term rates, there's long-term rates. The short-term rates often experience larger swings than the long-term rates. Shorter-term loans tend to be linked to short-term interest rates like LIBOR. Longer permanent financings tend to be linked to the yield on the 10-year government treasury bill. In recent weeks, the yield on the 10-year treasury has fallen to the lowest level in 2 years. The U.S. dollar has remained persistently strong as uncertainty over global trade has sent investors globally looking for safety. The vehicle of choice seems to be the U.S. treasury bill, and that explains why the yield for the 10-year T-bill is falling. But since long-term mortgage rates are tied to the 10-year treasury, mortgage rates have also fallen to below 4% on the longer 30 and 35-year loans. In recent days, the White House has demanded that Mexico do its part to stem the tide of illegal immigrants coming from Central America. If Mexico doesn't do its part, the U.S. would impose a duty on imports coming from Mexico. That risk has in turn called into question the new U.S.-Mexico-Canada Free Trade Agreement, which in turn has increased short-term interest rates both in Canada and Mexico. The fact that rates have risen so quickly in Canada, we are now experiencing an inversion in the interest rates, that is, short-term interest rates that are considerably higher than long-term interest rates. The yield curve in the United States remains relatively flat, with short-term interest rates and long-term interest rates being relatively balanced. Federal Reserve continues to say that it's monitoring both inflation and economic activity. If there are signs of economic weakness, we could see a further rate cut in the U.S. later this year. Interest rates in Germany are still in negative territory at minus 0.25%, which continues to baffle me. I've understood that you might pay interest to borrow money, but I've never quite understood the idea of paying someone to take your money. Keeping it in cash under your mattress is a much better deal. In fact, when you consider that the U.S. economy is so much stronger than France, Spain, and the U.K., it doesn't make sense to me that U.S. interest rates should be much higher than interest rates in those other countries. In fact, Spain, France, and the U.K. have every bit as much trouble paying their public debts as the U.S. So when you factor in the risk premium that should be applied to those countries, interest rates should be much, much higher than they are in Europe than they are in the United States. So what does this all mean for real estate investors? I believe that there's room for interest rates to fall in the U.S. or for them to go up in Europe, and I believe that the period of low interest rates is here for a little while longer. That means the prices for commercial properties will broadly remain stable. Even a modest economic downturn will not have a dramatic negative impact on prices for commercial multifamily properties. If you're considering a bit of profit-taking or rebalancing your debt-to-equity ratios, now might be a good time to do that. If you have one more year remaining on a conventional loan, locking in for another 5 to 10-year term at today's rates would make a lot of sense, even if you had to pay a 1% prepayment penalty. Oftentimes, if there's only 1 year remaining on a loan, the bank may waive the prepayment penalty if you refinance with the same bank. They would rather keep the business, and waiving the prepayment penalty might be the necessary inducement for you to stay with your present bank. But even if you elect to pay the penalty and shop around elsewhere, remember that you're going to amortize that prepayment penalty over 5 or 7 or 10 years. So a 1% prepayment penalty has roughly the same cost as a 0.2% increase in interest rates over 5 years. If you can save more than 0.2% in the interest rate by refinancing, it would definitely be worth paying the prepayment penalty and getting locked in at a lower rate. Many people refinance in order to increase their loan amount or sometimes to reduce it. As long as you can maintain a responsible level of debt and a responsible debt coverage ratio, you might consider increasing your loan amounts and pulling out some equity to build up a war chest of some cash to prepare yourself for new acquisitions in the coming years. There's still a lot of money sitting on the sidelines, and while there aren't too many bargains in the market today, there will be a time when bargains start to reappear and you want to be sitting on cash ready to pounce when they do. As you think about that, have an awesome rest of your day. Go make some great things happen. We'll talk to you again tomorrow.